Welcome to WeekNGeek, your new comics preview for May 30th. I'm Mike Ortiz.
And I'm the Chris Brown.
What do you got?
This week I'm going to kick it off with, we've got Peter Panzer Faust issue 4. I really like this book. Last issue we got to meet Wendy, finally introduced to our ragtag group of misfits here. And yeah, I don't know, I'm looking forward to seeing where it's going to go. I think Curtis Wiebe's building a great little Peter Pan tale. The World War II background is very, very interesting. It is going to be an ongoing, as they had announced, you know, after the first couple were so successful. So, see where it goes. Then I've got, I'm going to do Exile on the Planet of the Apes, issue 3, which is, I believe, this is the continuing the Dr. Zaius stuff.
Yeah.
I really like this. As I've said before, this Planet of the Apes stuff's been really great. Yeah. I really like the artwork. I really like the storytelling. You know, this is Hardman's not doing the art on this one, but doing writing with his wife Karina Bechko. Yeah, they're doing great stuff. They get it. They're fans. Fun stuff. Then we've got finally the first issue of Superman Family Adventures.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, Superman Family Adventures. I've missed Tiny Titans. Yeah. It was a great send-off. That issue 50 was great. And it felt like it led into this. He did a great job of sort of letting everyone kind of move on, and now we're getting to Superman.
I'm really interested in listening to interviews with the guys, how they're really blending modern Superman comics, Silver Age Superman comics, the movie, the cartoons, you know, really.
Yes.
This is probably going to strangely be the most iconic Superman book out there.
And he's got the new costume.
Yeah.
So no red undies.
I mean, it's no red undies, but it's not armored. So
that's true.
So yeah.
The cape looks similar. He's got the red thing around the back.
So again, it's this interesting blend of all the different versions of Superman, because, you know, these guys love all the versions of Superman.
Kind of looks a little more grown up than he did in Tiny Titans.
So good stuff.
Yeah, I'm glad Art gets to write a Superman title. And gets to do whatever he wants, you know, blending all of the mythos is great. We've got American Vampire number 27. This book's been awesome. Scott Snyder is leading the charge and writing some of the best horror-themed comics around right now. And I would include Batman in that. I mean, he's got a really dark, cool, creepy feel going in that book right now. And Batman's the best it's ever been, and this is the first thing that got my attention with him.
Yeah.
Was American Vampire. I remember reading the Where was I? Something about American Vampire.
Yeah.
When I started reading this book here, I remember when Stephen King was attached to it, and I thought, after reading it, wow, I like that other guy better than I like Stephen King's story.
A lot of people said that.
And here we are, you know, 2 years later with American Vampire. Great stuff. This, I believe, is still in the 50s storyline here. Let's see if they're still following those characters there. Yeah, it looks indeed like it is. Great stuff. Love Scott Snyder. Love American Vampire. Also really liking Animal Man by Jeff Lemire. And that's tying in with Swamp Thing and Scott Snyder. And we've got the Animal Man Annual number one here. So I believe this is going to tie in. I'm hoping this ties into everything. Or is this
I think this is, at least from what I remember, this is not... It's tying in and then it's another story of the Rot.
Gotcha, so but you could just jump on.
Right, yeah. So this is not like a continuation of the last issue.
Okay.
This is a little bit of backstory for the big story that's going on right now in Swamp Thing and Animal Man.
Love that book. So creepy, so good. All right, next we'll do Ghostbusters number 9. Great fun book. Mm-hmm. IDW, awesome. Love IDW, blah, blah, blah. We go on and on about this every week. Who knew I was going to get into all of these, licensed books, and a company like IDW was going to sway me and suck me in. I think they were just doing some awesome stuff, even without their licensed stuff. I loved that Frankenstein Alive a couple weeks ago. Mm-hmm. Loved that Smoke and Mirrors book.
Yeah.
This Ghostbusters book, as I've said before, feels like the movies. It does not feel like the cartoon, even if it has a similar animation to... You know, Egon does look a little different, but they still have that cartoonish sort of vibe. But it feels like the movies. The movie's not the cartoon, per se. Razzle number 14 by Jeff Smith. We're building towards the end here. This is not as long a story arc as Bone is. Mm. This is, I think, only going to go maybe a few more issues, and they're wrapping it up. And dimension hopping and art thievery and... Really, really strange book. I mean, it was only coming out quarterly, which made it tough. This is going to make a nice you know,
that's
little,
what I'm
little
for.
Paperback with, you know, 20 issues or whatever it ends up being here. I don't even think it's going to be that many, maybe 16. It'll be nice to read as a whole big chunk rather than, you know, this, what is it, amount of 16-issue story over the course of 4
that's
years
That's why
or
I
so.
Stopped getting the individual issues, is they were so far apart, I couldn't remember what was going on. Okay. I just figured, look, I'll wait, read the whole thing when it was done.
And it'll read much better
that
way.
Yeah, I think so.
Hey, look, we got more IDW. We got Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Doing a great job over there. Yeah. The Ninja Turtles have been an awesome. I didn't know what to think when it first restarted. I really liked it. But I hadn't embraced the idea yet of all of the there's just different Ninja Turtles mythos. Yeah. And you have to accept that. And this is a reboot, and that's fine. And they did what they did with the previous series. Yeah. And there have been cartoons and all these other things that
and
have been a little different.
At least they are still teenaged and mutant.
Well, I don't think they're going to be that different in the Michael Bay movie. He's not going to totally Michael Bay it up the way it sounded in the in his nonsense. But, yeah, this is a fun book. You know, Kevin Eastman does, you know, have some something to do with the story there with Tom Waltz. And he's really enjoying what they're doing, and I am too.
Yeah, good stuff.
Then we have The Walking Dead number 98, building up to our issue number 100. This is Something to Fear, part 2.
Great covers on all of these.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, it's been some great stuff. We're getting more into this group. We're going to meet, you know, hopefully Negan soon here, and we're going to get more into finding out what's going on. They got a war brewing. Does this other camp have a lot of people? Do they have a few people? What the hell's going on over there?
And, you know, there was recently a zombie attack.
Yeah?
Yes,
there was in Miami.
Time to start catching up on The Walking Dead so we can learn how to survive.
Yeah, exactly. You know, apparently keep the bath salts away.
Yeah.
They're saying that was bath salts. And you know, the people are talking about the whole zombie attack thing. The first thing I thought of was Chew. Yeah. And I'm like, you know, everybody's, you know, talking zombie attack, and we're also talking about Chew TV show.
Yeah.
When you read about a guy eating a guy's face down in Miami, granted they were both naked, which made it weirder. Yeah. When you read about a guy eating another guy's face, that's not going to make great TV. Mm-hmm. That's creepy, and it's very, very creepy and disturbing.
At least maybe HBO.
Well, it was supposed to be on Showtime.
No, but I mean, two naked guys, one of them eating another guy's face. That's HBO material.
Yeah. You're right, I suppose.
I think that was in Game of Thrones.
But that is the bulk of my stack there.
I'm going to start off with Batman Annual. We've already sung the praises of Scott Snyder earlier in the show and for the past year.
Absolutely.
This is Scott Snyder plus Mr. Freeze. It's the introduction of Mr. Freeze of the DC
New
52. So, yeah, I've been a fan of Mr. Freeze ever since the Batman animated series. Not the Arnold Schwarzenegger one, but no.
Batman animated was great.
Yeah, great stuff. And you know, I'm sure this will be just as good as everything else that that's been going on in Batman. Next up, Amazing Spider-Man Annual. I don't know what this is about, but it's got New Avengers on the cover, Avengers on the cover. And I love
Avengers. We got to milk that train.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's not an AVX, but so we're a little bit of a break from the ends of the earth. But I've always loved annuals. I loved it when they all crossed over into each other. But I like it even more when they're just one solid long story that just gives you a little bit of closure and a little bit of finish. Next up, Super Crooks. I'm really enjoying this book. It's a good heist caper book with supervillains. It's basically supervillains meets Ocean's 11. But really a lot of fun, a lot of great characterizations, and I'm really surprised. The art is fantastic, and at least so far we're through two issues, we got the third issue, and Mark Miller still hasn't done anything. I mean, there was a little bit of over-the-top violence in the last one, but he still is kind of like, it's almost like when
I haven't read issue two yet. I love the first one.
When he's working on his own stuff, except for Kick-Ass, he seems to be reining it in a little bit. Like, he respects his own stuff more than he respects other stuff. But, yeah, it's kind of like this, you know, if he was doing stuff is kind of like, I don't want to say subtle, but at least as reined in as this in Marvel, it might have been a little bit more fun. But this has been a great book. I really, really love it. I'm surprised how much I like all of the creator-owned stuff that he's doing now. I think it's good that he's left the big two for his own stuff, because you can tell with some of these guys, you could really tell that their heart's in the stuff that they really
are. Those are still icon books, though.
Yeah, but he owns it.
That's true.
You know,
he's owns totally it. Left Marvel. He's keeping that door open.
But Marvel doesn't make that much money off of this, and he does have a book coming out from Image.
Does he? Okay.
So who knows? Maybe he's slowly transitioning or doing a little bit of everywhere. But either way, when it's his stuff and he gets all the movie money, he puts a little more work into it. Next up is FF. Now that the big storyline's done, I don't know where they're going, but it's still a lot of fun. It's Jonathan Hickman. It's the kids. I'm curious as to whether or not they're going to continue FF once Hickman's
That's
gone.
That's what I'm wondering. I haven't heard anything yet.
I imagine they will, just because apparently the sales are pretty good, so they'll, you know.
Okay.
So I don't know how well it'll tie in, but that's October. So for now, let's just enjoy some more Jonathan Hickman. Future Foundation, First Family, Fantastic Four, whatever it is, it's all good stuff. Next up, we're talking about IDW. And IDW is the current home of John Byrne and Next Men Aftermath. This has got some time travel stuff going on in it.
Next Men has done a lot of time travel stuff.
There was a lot of that, but they've gone back in time. You're seeing the kids who these characters are looking for the kids who will eventually become the Next Men. So there's a lot of weird stuff going on. I get this strange feeling that this is really wrapping up. That, you know, when this particular Next Men Aftermath is done, the Next Men story will be done. There's a lot of references to the original series still. And to the point where it's like I'm reading stuff going, I kind of remember that.
Yeah, that was over 10 years ago.
But I actually kind of appreciate that he's actually making this. There's like there was no gap. This is just continuing where it left off. Good stuff.
Is that a young Aldous Hilltop?
You know, I was wondering that.
Okay, all right.
It's hard to tell because most of John Byrne's faces look the same. Next up is America's Got Powers number 2. The first one was pretty good. I actually liked it quite a bit. I'm a big fan of Brian Hitch. An interesting idea where you've got basically a superhero version of American Idol. It's got a little bit of Rising Stars mixed in too with this kind of like single event that creates all these people. But, good stuff. Yet another
I like clever. How everyone's comparing it to American Idol, but nobody's comparing it to Stan Lee's Who Wants to Be a Superhero.
the book's pretty good. Nobody wants to bash it. At least it's not Stripperella, I guess. But good, solid stuff. I mean, I tried, was it Jonathan Ames, I think, is the writer? Not Jonathan Ames.
No.
Whatever the guy who
Jonathan
the,
Ross,
Jonathan Ross, the British TV guy.
I tried to get bored to death,
which would be cool. He should do it that way. He did that book, Turf.
Oh yeah,
and I remember that. I tried it out. I didn't really like the writing in it so much. You could tell it was someone who was taking their first shot at writing a comic book and hadn't quite got it yet. But here he's figured it out, and of course Brian Hitch, one of my favorites. Next up, Wolverine and the X-Men. This is Avengers versus X-Men, so I don't know what's going on in this book other than there's going to be Avengers fighting X-Men. But, this has
been... That's good enough. We've got a lot of that lately. So.
Yeah, I mean, I'm really enjoying the series in general, both the Avengers versus X-Men. Wolverine and the X-Men is the best X-book out there right now. A lot of good characterizations going on.
Shocking to me.
Yeah, I know. I'm still surprised that I'm buying a Wolverine book and a Jason Aaron book when I swore I'd never buy either of them. But good stuff. This has really been one of the best of the AVX books and one of the best X book. So that's pretty much my stack.
All right, brings me to the top of my stack here. We've got Grim Leaper number 1 by Curtis Wiebe. I really dig his stuff a lot. You know, I've been loving his Peter Panzer Faust. I loved Greenwake. I think he's a really talented writer, and I'm curious to see what this book's about. I believe it's some kind of sci-fi thing. Image has been doing some great stuff. He's, like I said, a really talented writer. I've watched him explore several different genres, from Greenwake doing this straight-up horror to, you know, what he's doing with Peter Panzerfaust. Let's see what he does with sci-fi. I'm sure it'll be great, and I'm looking forward to it.
My top is yet another IDW book, and yet another
You're
licensed
stealing the show
book,
this week.
But it's Star Trek Doctor Who. Big fan of Star Trek and big fan of Doctor Who. I don't get either of the books separately.
Okay, put together.
I actually used to get the IDW Star Trek books, and they are the best Star Trek books, licensed book Star Trek books that anyone's ever done. I've tried every version, you know, the Marvel, the Gold Key, the other Marvel, the DC, and clearly this was the best of the Star Trek licensed properties. Malibu even did it for a while.
Oh yeah, yes they did.
And but I dropped off just because, you know, I get a lot of comic books, and I got Star Trek in movies and TV shows, and they started doing a lot of miniseries. So I just sort of let it slide, but this just got me back on because this is something I would like to see for real. We're never going to see a Doctor Who Star Trek crossover on television, but we're going to get it here. It's the Next Generation meets the Matt Smith Doctor, although I think down the road there's a Tom Baker Doctor and even maybe a Captain Kirk in there. But okay. two of the best sci-fi franchises meeting, and you know, I just can't.
It's a wonder it hasn't happened before.
Yeah. Great stuff. I mean, IDW, they've got both of those licenses.
Well, I was just going to say, this seems like this is IDW's Alien versus Predator.
Yeah, exactly. That's a great way to describe it. That is it. And you know, it just
so
makes
who
me
knows?
Wonder,
if there's enough of this to be made, you will see it as a movie.
That's true. But now it's like, I want to see Star Trek and Ghostbusters. And maybe Doctor Who meets the Ninja Turtles. I mean, with all of this licensed stuff out there that IDW's got, they did that Infestation kind of...
Right, and that's how they blended together.
They didn't like directly cross over, but they all kind of shared a theme. So yeah, maybe we'll get some Doctor Who meets G.I. Joe. You know, that would be some... Oh man, Star Trek meets Transformers?
Just thinking that.
Oh, come on. Make that happen, somebody.
Yes, that would be pretty awesome.
So yeah, I mean, this is just loads of fun. You know, I'm always a fan of, like, you know, the Marvel versus DC stuff, Avengers versus X-Men. You get two things I like, you make them fight, make them team up. I love it. So that's my top.
Right on. Well, with that is your Week in Geek.